Hello everyone. On behalf of Beacon House School System, the organizer of School of Tomorrow events, I'd like to welcome you all to A World of Tomorrow, From Darkness to Light, the 12th edition of SOT events. And it's fully virtual. The nonprofit SOT event series was launched by Beacon House in 2000 as part of its CSR and to help inform the direction of the organization while also engaging global communities in conversations shaping the future of schools and society. My name is Mehmooza Faraz, and I am moderating this session on behalf of Beacon House. I'm a journalist, and let me just introduce all my panelists before I discuss our topic. So we have with us Mavi Mazar, Salim H. Ali, and Kamal Mumtaz Saab. I'll start with Mavi. She's an architect and heritage consultant based out of Karachi. Her work focuses on the changing footprint of Karachi's inner city through archives and constant visual ethnography of Purana Sheher, Old Town, versus Naya Sheher, the new and reclaimed town. Mavi Mazar currently serves on several government boards and actively participates in numerous city rehabilitation politics and urban interventions. She's currently on an academic sabbatical at Goldsmiths University of London. Salim H. Ali is Blue and Gold Distinguished Professorship of Energy and the Environment at the University of Delaware, USA, a professorial research fellow at the University of Queensland, Australia, and a senior fellow at Columbia University Center on Sustainable Investment, USA. His research focuses on environmental security, climate diplomacy, and industrial ecology, particularly involving extractive industries. Professor Ali's fieldwork experience has spanned over 100 countries on 6 continents, for which he has also been named a National Geographic Explorer and a Young Global Leader by the World Economic Forum. And Kamal Mumtaz Saab needs no introduction, but of course we have to give an introduction for our audience. He re-established 5-year course in architecture at National College of Arts, Lahore, as a professor and head of department. He's led consultants team in preparing Lahore Urban Development and Traffic Study, including long and short-term planning framework for metropolitan area of Lahore and upgrading of Walled City. He's the author of books, Architecture in Pakistan and Modernity and Tradition. And he's the member of the steering committee of the Aga Khan Award for Architecture. And he also got Sitara Imtiaz in 2019, awarded by the government of Pakistan for services to architecture. And he's the founder member of the Lahore Conservation Society. So let me introduce the topic now. It's about the newly launched Orange Train. After a 5-year gestation period, Pakistan's first ever metro service commenced commercial operations in Lahore in October 2020, just a month ago, aiming to address the triad of choke roads, pollution, and extended commuter times, while also providing an affordable option to the public. However, the much-hyped project has prompted considerable criticism and controversy, with critics questioning its worth, return on investment, lack of transparency, and allegedly irreparable damage caused to both environment and heritage sites. So this panel will actually discuss and will delve deeper into the controversies and questions surrounding the newly inaugurated Orange Train. So my first question for all panelists is that, you know, critics argue that the Orange Line was never self-sustaining. In the long term, is the project more of an asset or a liability? And Kamal Saab, I'd like to start with you, since you worked on this along these lines as well.
Yes, I think the first and most important thing about this project is it is an economic disaster. And I'll just tell you that to run this train, counting the subsidy and the markup that we have to pay back to the donors, it's going to cost us 15 million rupees every day. For the price of 15 million rupees a day, we can buy 36 buses every day. Where is this money going to come from? We are already more than bankrupt. There is no money. How on earth are we going to pay for this? So that's economically, it's projects like these. This is not the only project, but it's these kind of projects which we just cannot afford.
And Salim, would you like to add something to this? What Carlos has said, I'll come to the specific questions in your field and Mavi's field later, but I'd like everybody to answer this.
First of all, I have immense respect for the conservationists who have tried to shepherd this project towards more responsible environmental planning. However, I respectfully disagree with the cost-benefit analysis which is presented. First of all, I'd say that public transit projects are not meant to be profit makers. Most of them in the world are running at a loss because they're a public service. They are like hospitals or the postal service. It's the responsibility of the government to provide certain essential services. And the right to mobility, now even under the US Supreme Court, is considered a basic right of citizens. So it cannot be used in the same way as if you're opening a shopping mall to do a cost-benefit analysis. The public service. Second is the calculations which are done now around public transit. And I serve on two United Nations panels which engage with sustainable cities issues. This cost benefit has to be looked at from the perspective of a longer term planning horizon. What is it going to do in terms of the property value? What is it going to do in terms of income coming in from future tourism, access, commerce? So it's a much more different kind of calculation. Now, as far as the debt and those concerns that are there, of course, there needs to be very appropriate management for it. But this has been done as an international partnership. And some of the risk is going to be absorbed across borders, even though there is a lot of conflicting views in the media. So I would say kudos to the activists for keeping the pressure to make this project responsible. I admire them for it, but I think they shouldn't throw the baby out with the bathwater.
And Mavi, do you also think that, do you think it's an asset or a liability?
I mean, for me, I think ecologically, environmentally, it is a very major liability. It cuts through a visual aspect of the city as a very brutal spine going from inner to outwards. And that way, one has to see the aesthetics and the sensibility of how my property line is disrupted by the spine. And that way, I feel it is a liability for the larger run of the city.
Okay. So, Kamal Saab, what does a significant reduction in pollution resulting from fewer cars on the road offset the environmental concerns of the critics? Whether it's the Orange Line or the metro train, sorry, metro bus.
Look, Lahore has daily trips, 12 million. The capacity of this train serves 2% of Lahore's commuter traffic. And the rest of the country, the citizens have to pay for this. As for pollution, it's going to consume 75 megawatts of uninterrupted electricity all the time. How are we going to produce that electricity? Is it going to come out of thin air? We're going to set up coal plants? And there's already a huge shortage of supply compared with the demand for this city. Where is this money, this electricity going to come from? And how much traffic is it going to reduce? More than 60% of the daily traffic, commuter traffic in Lahore is within 5 to 10 kilometers. It's by foot, by bicycles, and by motorcycles. The distances that the population needs to travel is not 27 kilometers. These kind of things are designed for totally different kind of urban formations. This is a historic, dense city in which there is not a big concentration of the CBD with suburban. Now, this metro train, amongst its impacts, is going to promote urban sprawl. or we're going to lose more green space. This is not going to solve the people's daily commuting problems. A bus, and we can, as I said, I can have fill the city with buses. They can negotiate narrow streets and crisscross a single line. Even this metro system was designed as an underground when it came to the central areas. Now, with this overhead, Lahore can never have an integrated urban transport system anymore. So this is one disaster after another. And it's the simple, I mean, we just don't have the money to pay for these kinds of luxuries, prestige projects. 2% of the population is being served at a cost of $15 million per day. What kind of economic sense does that make? Why don't you, we have the right of way, very good road infrastructure. All we need is better traffic management and lots of buses. That will really help 90% of the people who need to move. And in any case, why do you have to, why do you need vehicularized solution to the transportation when the distances people are traveling are just 5 to 10 kilometers? Why not plan your cities better so that you don't you don't have to travel more than 2 kilometers to work, to school? Most of the commuting traffic is to school and to work. Why are they so far distant? So it doesn't need these kind of toys to solve the problems of the city or the citizens. We just, and I keep repeating, it is not affordable.
Okay, Professor Salim, before I come to you, I'd like to ask Marvi. A lot of people argue that a city like Karachi, which is such a huge city, needs something like the orange train or, you know, other public transport, because they don't have very good public transport in Karachi. So what do you think, you know, do you agree with Kamal Saab that Lahore's urban planning should have been better, and, you know, the transport system could have been better and for the environment as well as cost effective? And what about Karachi?
Thanks. I, as an architect, I mean, activism comes like later stage, but as a designer, as a point of like a citizen living in a city which is so complex, especially in the diaspora of South Asia, I would really like to understand what does the property line does above and under. So even if you're making an overhead, what kind of spaces are you creating under those overheads? Those kind of becomes into a dark zones. Do they become dark zones? How are they incorporated and designed? It's very easy to consult them as the green spaces or green belt, but does that work in our context, or it becomes an encroachment land? So those kind of complexities and overlayering of land interests the idea of how planning is done. So that is one point of view of looking at such overheads and undergrounds. In Karachi, they were trying to make an overhead on main Emijana Road, which is flanked by historical buildings on left and right. And thanks to RF Hassan and a couple of other management groups, that it was proposed as an underground construction rather than overground, because you're also cutting through a visual dissection towards the city. So you also have to look from a very sensitive point of view, like how people are interacting to that visual cut. And it also depends, like, not only my property line is important, but even my visual line is very important, what I see outside of my frame. So that way, I feel this insensitive way of designing and imposing from top down makes a huge difference in a larger city for a longer future outcome.
Okay. And Professor Ali, as an environmentalist, do you think that, you know, there will be a significant reduction in pollution because of the orange train? How do you see the entire project?
Again, you have to take a longer term vision. With large infrastructure projects, the benefits environmentally will no doubt be realized from the point of view of the growth trajectory of a city like Lahore, which is growing very rapidly And all of the points Kamal Saab very eloquently made around high density urban settlement with a core, historic preservation, all those are actually the kinds of places where you do want to have rapid access. Because if you start to have much more devolved access with cars and buses, as the city is growing at such a large rate, as Lahore is, you're going to end up in a situation with even more gridlock. And the way in which, from a planning perspective, the orange line is has been made perpendicular to the existing metro bus service. And all of the various stations along the line are very carefully designed so that they are then connected to other bus networks. It passes through the main central railway station in Lahore. It goes to UET, the major engineering university, on the one hand. It goes on the other end towards Thokar Niyazbek, which is a major growth center. So there has been a lot of effort made into figuring out where this is going to have an impact. So the 2%, first of all, the 2% is going to lead to a much greater impact across the board. Secondly, that's the 2% which is most vulnerable. People like from the middle class who already have air-conditioned cars, they don't have to worry about it. They can be multitasking, sitting with the driver and doing what they do. It's the poor people, and especially women, who will benefit from this. And there have been studies, I'm basing this on research, post-facto research, which has been done on the metro bus service, which was also very controversial initially, that it has benefited women the most and lower income women. So I have to think of it in a systems way. Of course, there is no free lunch. Everything is going to have some impact. Yes, I wish that Choburji was not occluded by it, but you have to think of it in a larger context. And access for tourists to be able to go to these places is very important. Now, Marvi's point is also very valid, that you have to design the physical architecture in a way that it's appealing. But from all I have seen, and I'm a Lahori through and through, grew up in Lahore, it's a very dear city to me, they have made that effort. Look at the design of the metro stations. They have put them, places where they put them underground. There was a process through the judicial system. The late Asma Jahangir went through a process of litigating on this, along with many others. That's great. You know, that's the role of civil society. You push the envelope. They won in one court, then the Supreme Court overturned the case, but the Supreme Court put in 31 conditions that the planning authorities have to meet. That's how a functional deliberative planning process should work. Everyone is not going to be pleased. The absolute conservationists will not be pleased. But at the same time, this has not been just completely top down. There has been a deliberative engagement with the whole process. And then UNESCO, who was also alerted to this because of Shalimar, they came back and in the last meeting, they said that they felt satisfied with the conditions and mitigating efforts that had been made. So that's what gives me confidence.
Okay, so Kamal Saab, jo baat abhi Professor Ali ne bhi kiya, because a lot of people say this, ke shayad aap logo ko, jis tarah hum logo pe bhi is cheez ke, jab hum sawal uthate hain, to ek criticism bhi aata hai ki aap logon ke paas to shayad apni gaadiyan hain, you have your own transport, so that's why aap logon ko shayad public transport ki itni qadar nahi hai, aur ye ke you guys, when we go abroad, we all use public transport. तो उस इस सारी बात को जैसा प्रोफेसर अली ने भी कहा कि यूनेस्को और उनकी ये स्टैंडर्ड्स को फिर मीट भी किए, तो आपने आपसे मैं बात करना चाह रही हूँ, एक तो इकोनॉमिक एस्पेक्ट, यू आर एक्चुअली सेइंग दैट यू नो बसेस, वी कुड हैव बॉट मोर बसेस, या वी कुड हैव डन अ बेटर प्लानिंग, और उसके बाद हम ये सारा कुछ करते, तो व्हाट डू यू से टू दैट एक्चुअली, बिकॉज एक तरफ ये एम्प्लॉयमेंट बेनिफिट्स भी क्रिएट करे, लाइक इट हैज क्रिएटेड जॉब्स फॉर मोर देन 3000 पीपल and it's going to give opportunities to more people. So phir usko aap cost benefit analysis iska kis tarike se karte hain? Also I'd like you to shed some light on urban planning, ki agar isko kis tarike se behtar plan kiya ja sakta tha, ki agar orange line ke ye route na hota, ya kis tarike se, because we do need public transport.
Ki dekhiye, ek baat Salim sahab ne jo kari, ki iske is tarah ki cheeze deliberate system प्लानिंग और बहुत सारे फैक्टर्स देख के करते हैं. लाहौर बहुत बड़ा शहर है, इसके लिए वेरी डिलिबरेटिव कॉम्प्रिहेंसिव इंटीग्रेटेड मल्टीडिसिप्लिनरी इन्वेस्टिगेशन एनालिसिस ये सब हो चुका है. दिस वॉज डन इन 2012-13 बाय एफजाइका फंडेड प्लान विच द गवर्नमेंट आस्क फॉर, लाहौर अर्बन ट्रांसपोर्ट मास्टर प्लान. उस प्लान के अंदर ये ऑरेंज ट्रेन ऊपर से गुजरती हुई नहीं थी. उसके अंदर चार पांच लाइंस जो सेंट्रल एरिया में आके अंडरग्राउंड होनी थी, इन्होंने इंटरसेक्शन के लिए स्टेशंस होने थे. पहला काम आपने ये किया कि ग्रीन लाइन हवा में उड़ा दी. वो वहीं पे सारा अर्बन फ्यूचर इंटीग्रेटेड प्लान खत्म हो गया. उसको मजीद सील करने के लिए आपने ऑरेंज ट्रेन भी हवा में उड़ा दी. और जब बहुत डर लगा कि ये हमारे जजेस नाराज हो जाएंगे, तो उनके सामने से आपने उसको नजरों से गायब कर दिया. दैट इज नॉट एन अंडरग्राउंड सिस्टम, दैट्स जस्ट अ कट टनल. तो और उस करने में आपके 11 लिस्टेड प्रोटेक्टेड मॉन्यूमेंट्स मुतासिर हुए हैं, और ये सिर्फ लिस्टेड मॉन्यूमेंट्स हैं. मैं अभी हेरिटेज की बात नहीं करता, ये चलिए नखरे हैं, टूरिस्ट आप कहते हैं, पता नहीं कहाँ है टूरिस्ट, कौन से टूरिस्ट, कितने टूरिस्ट, क्या क्या बात कर रहे हैं आप. कह रहे हैं कि रैपिड ट्रांजिट चाहिए गरीबों को, गरीब किधर रहते हैं. डू यू नो दैट 90% ऑफ द डिवेलप्ड अर्बन एरिया ऑफ लाहौर इज लो डेंसिटी. लो डेंसिटी डज नॉट मीन लो इनकम. लो इनकम families, the congestion, high density around walled city, north of the railway line, ye wahan pe is qisam. Why do you need these transport systems to go from one place to another? Where are the places where people live? Where are the places where the schools are? Where are their workplaces? They are not the kind of urban structure which calls for and this kind of rapid transport. What you need is to facilitate, you want to facilitate the poor, give them better walking, cycling cities, get rid of this. Aap pollution ki baat karte hain, aapke motor cars, kitni motorein kam ho jayengi? Which area is it serving? This is ridiculous. It is counter to any sense. Aap baat karte hain, we should look at the larger picture. The larger picture, all these kinds of projects. Abhi ye metro train ko hum afford nahi kar sakte. You're going to go in for a Ravi mega city and then develop islands in Sindh. You are going to make convert the forest into a tourist city. For God's sake, this is what is making us poor. If you're worried about the poor, stop these ridiculous show projects. They are making us poor. Look at the larger picture. And the poverty is destroying our environment. Please do look at the larger picture. It's projects like these that are destroying the world. It's these kind of mega projects, mega tourism, jumbo jets. For God's sake, wake up, Salim Saab. Look at the larger picture and do look at a sensible, rational, integrated systems thinking for the actual city that you're designing for. This train does not make any sense.
As I said, I have great respect for Kamal Saab and their efforts. First of all, I am not defending all mega projects by any means. I think, for example, the kind of activity in Dubai is appalling. The kind of prestige, those are what I call prestige projects. For example, the Palm or the Atlantis in Dubai, absurd amounts of land being taken from the coastal continental shelf, that is completely out of the question. And if Pakistan tries to emulate that, I would be the first person to go against that. And I think some of the Karachi projects are deplorable in that regard. I also think that the Ravi project, the only part I would justify on the Ravi project is to make an esplanade, which is along the river, a very modest project, certainly not these huge skyscrapers and all which have been put forward. So I totally agree with you. Most mega projects are ill-informed, and they are not often thought through. However, if you look at any major city in the world, which is over 5 million people and is claiming to be a sustainable city, it will have some kind of rapid transit system. I'll give you an example of our neighboring country, Iran. I've been to Tehran. Tehran built a metro system during the Iran-Iraq war at the height of a most difficult time financially for the country. And they built it because they realized how important it would be for the long-term trajectory of Tehran. And if you visit Tehran now, that metro has been one of the real saving graces economically of the city in terms of how those people have been able to get around. A lot of people were against that at the time too. So all I'm saying is give it a chance. And I personally think that the noble efforts of the conservationists, now that the project is done, you went through a judicial process, you made your voice heard, and I think you made some really valuable contributions. Now let's try to make this project work in a way so that it is ecologically more reliable, you get more education for the community, you get the level, the volume of participation, people using it. And we cannot expect poor people to be biking at a, 50 degrees centigrade in summer. I think they deserve to have just the same kind of amenities and air-conditioned travel as the Saab and Begum Saab. I personally think we should be looking at, and certainly the walled city, my father came from the Bhati Gate area. I have great affection for the walled city. There has been an effort made to pedestrianize the walled city. They have closed all the open sewers and so on. So that should continue. I'm not against that. The work Rafi Alam is doing with cycling and Lahore, wonderful. All power to them. But it's not an either or. With a city as big as Lahore, you need both. So that's how it is.
I would like to add something. This is a little bit like late in the conversation, but the pandemic has also taught us so much right now in terms of like what cities need to be in London, which is far beyond with the infrastructure of the underground and overgrounds. They themselves are questioning right now that what is this transition like doing to a person? Because most of the people here right now are cycling and walking. And, they have these green corridors, which are helping them into being into this pedestrian movement right now and cycling overall. It's not just that ek din Sunday ko aapne cycling group nikal diya, what Rafe or like even in Karachi is doing. It needs to be part of your everyday living. And that is what like architectural whole dynamics of conversation has changed post pandemic. And that right now, I can't even imagine what these train systems are going to do with a lot of population traveling into that when we have this intense parallel health factor going on. But right now, that's like late in conversation that train system has been constructed. But moving beyond that, I keep questioning, what is the future of cities? Does it need development or does it need rehabilitation and restoration? And by restoration, I don't mean by heritage, but cities being restored. I mean, I think in South Asia, the cities need to be looked into in a more restoration point of view rather than a development point of view. We can't afford these mega projects. And as you said, Salim, that's a great point where you're saying okay, you're not in favor of these island reclamations and all. But like Karachi, I mean, already we've started exploring and started witnessing. I think the witness part is like such an interesting terminology right now. In last urban flooding, we saw the most posh area being underwater and the sea level increasing. We are constantly talking about gaining more land. And all of this falls into this being high on development. And I think Orange Line is one of the factors which connects to this idea of development.
Maybe this is a related question, because obviously this is also your forte, jo community displacement hoti hai because of such mega projects. Ye abhi jis tarah Kamil saab ne baat ki, wo islands in Sindh aur baaki jo is tarah ke project par abhi River Ravi front wale project ki bhi baat ki, uske upar bhi kafi discussion chal rahi hai. To community displacement ka isme kya किया जा सकता है. जिस तरह हम बात करें कि पब्लिक ट्रांसपोर्ट बेनिफिट्स पीपल पुअर पीपल ऑल्सो लॉट एक्चुअली, तो ये जो कम्युनिटी डिस्प्लेसमेंट होती है वो भी हमने देखा है कि काफी गरीबों की होती है, और जिस तरह की फिर उनको उसकी कंपनसेशन दी जाती है या नहीं दी जाती या वो वेट करते रहते हैं, उसके ऊपर भी अगर आप इफ यू कैन शेड सम लाइट ऑन दैट.
आई मीन यू नो आपके सामने काफ़ी एग्जाम्पल्स हैं. वज़ीर ख़ान मस्जिद की जब रेस्टोरेशन हो रही थी और वर्ल्ड सिटी ने अथॉरिटी ने जब वो चीज़ें ठीक करना शुरू करी, तो उसके आसपास क्या हुआ? उसके पास यही हुआ कि गरीब लोगों के जो छोटे छोटे घर थे उनको मूव आउट करके अब एक होटल आ रहा है. तो जेंट्रिफिकेशन का एक बहुत ही इंपॉर्टेंट एलिमेंट होता है. अभी मुझे ये नहीं पता कि ऑरेंज लाइन अभी अमूमन बाहर मुल्क में या कहीं और किसी दुनिया में जहाँ पे भी ट्रेन स्टेशन का जो मेन गेट होता है उसके आसपास की प्रॉपर्टी स्टार्ट्स यू नो डेवलपिंग इन अनदर वे, कि आप उनके घरों को जो गरीब लोग होते हैं वो मूव आउट होना शुरू हो जाते हैं क्योंकि आपका वर्किंग तबका वहाँ पे रहना शुरू हो जाता है, कॉलेजेस सामने होते हैं, इस तरह की चीज़ें हो जाती हैं. I yet have to see research wise what happens in Pakistan when you start developing and what happens around those areas, how does gentrification starts taking place in those zones, and of course your vulnerable community gets affected the most. Wo aapka sabse pehla hota hai jisko aap shift out karte hain because you start buying land and you start like occupying land, and this whole idea of like occupancy of land for real estate purposes, I mean we've witnessed in Karachi tremendously as soon as a reclamation starts takes place or any park starts being developed. Port Grand, Lalazar Road jab ban raha tha main aapke port ki taraf, we started seeing that ke purani families ko move out hona pada tha, and just because you know you started government started making these institutions. So is tarah ki cheeze to ye to sab study ke तहत pata chalega na, documentation. Aur ek aur jo masla jo sabse bada ye hota hai ki hamari documentation ruk jati hai jab project shuru ho jata hai, that the documentation needs to take place and in a continuous way to see what are the effects of that area.
कामत साहब, आपको इसके बारे में ये कम्युनिटी डिस्प्लेसमेंट जो खासतौर पे ऑरेंज ट्रेन, बिकॉज आपने इसके ऊपर काम भी किया था, तो अगर इसके बारे में आप कुछ बता सकें.
देखिए, जो तो डायरेक्टली ऑरेंज ट्रेन बनाने के सिलसिले में डिस्प्लेसमेंट हुआ वो तो इट इज जस्ट स्कैंडलस. पूरा का पूरा मोहल्ला पुरानी अनारकली इज लाइक अ बॉम्ब साइट. जो लोग वहाँ से डिस्प्लेस हुए उनकी जिंदगियाँ डिसरप्ट हुई, जो नज़दीक स्कूल्स में जाते थे सारी फैसिलिटीज, दोस्त, नौकरी, काम, सब चीज़ डिसरप्ट हुआ. सो ये सब आप जो कहते हैं कि लाहौर इज एक्सपेंडिंग वेरी रैपिडली, सलीम साहब डू यू नो व्हाट इज एक्सपेंडिंग इन लाहौर? इट्स द अर्बन एरिया दैट इज एक्सपेंडिंग. Why is it expanding? It has nothing to do with the population growth. The population growth at its peak was growing at about 4% per annum. It has now gone down to something like 3 or less than 3% per annum, and it is going down in Lahore, in Pakistan, in the world. At the same time, Lahore's urban expansion has gone never below 7% per annum. It went up to 14% per annum, and then 24% per annum. The last count was 40% expansion of urban area per annum. Who is this serving? It's not the population. As I said, all of this urban expansion is low density. It's the barrier towns, the defense areas, new Lahore, LDA, these other schemes. Who is going to benefit is the mega bucks, the people like Malik, whatever his name is. They are going to be served by these rapid transit. This rapid transport is only going to facilitate and encourage the destruction of the green area, not to serve the population of Lahore. It's to serve the big investors from Dubai.
May I just quickly note that what Kamil Saab is saying with regard to the population growth and the difference with the urban infrastructure growth, that is precisely the kind of situation where rapid transit is helpful. Because what happens is that when you get rapid transit, people have more incentive to stay in the core of the city rather than going out. If you look at all of the major cities which have had urban transit and improved their access to the urban core, like getting to Anarkali right now from Thokar Niyazbek by car would take you 2 hours on some days, right? If you are able to get on it through that kind of rapid transit system in 15 to 20 minutes, you have far more incentive to actually stay in the core. So I personally think that this exact argument can be used for that. The second thing is population growth statistics are often misunderstood. Yes, the rate of population growth is decreasing all over, but population is still growing, and we are our planning horizon is 30 to 50 years. So in Pakistan, we are still looking at a very high population absolute number because of that growth. And so that's what we have to plan for. The average life of, you know, this kind of a system, 30 to 50 years before it may require some kind of revamping. So I think we have to keep that in perspective as well.
Now, I must say that this whole business of rapid transport is directly connected with the nature of urbanization. If you have these megalopolises which spread for 20, 30, 40 miles across, then, and if your workplaces are located in the central business district, and if the population, this is an example, for instance, typically Manhattan, which has the highest densities of the United States boroughs. Now, half the population moves in daily commute from suburbs. This is not Lahore. Lahore is a totally different kind of demography, a different kind of urban structure. You don't need, where did the land prices start shooting up? It's the outskirts who are going to be served by these rapid transit. You are just facilitating unnecessarily. If you really want to take care of the population expansion of Lahore, then densify this 90% where you already have invested infrastructure in roads, water supply, sewerage. Why do you need vehicular transport if you plan your cities to have all the resident population, the same number of jobs, schools, social services within walking distance? You don't need vehicularized transportation. It's only when you do this kind of idiotic urbanism that we have been following, not just in Lahore, the whole world over. This is suicidal. It is killing us. These very cities are consuming most of the resources, are depleting our resources. They are polluting the waters, everything. Why do you keep on doing this and encouraging it with money you don't have?
Now, may I just compare Lahore and Islamabad? Because I think what Kamil Saab is saying, the kind of development that he's envisaging, where people would have walkable districts and all contained and you have less public transport. Actually, Islamabad was designed for that, polycentric. Each sector has its own commercial center, residential around green space, right? Doxiadis, the great urban planner who's considered one of the fathers of ecological planning, that was his vision. And it could happen in Islamabad because it was a planned city. Unfortunately, we haven't capitalized on it as much as we could. In Lahore, it's an ancient city, and it's very difficult to calibrate, you know, where are people living, when and why. I totally agree with Kamal Saab that you need to actually densify the urban core. There are two reasons which that has not happened. One is we need to be able to have much more vertical infrastructure developed, which is a problem in Pakistan generally, because there has been intermittent access to electricity. So if you do not, you know, to build taller buildings where you have apartments, people living in apartments, you need to have elevators. And if you don't have stable access to electricity, you can't do that. And so that's been a problem. Karachi, it's been a little bit better. But
no, Salim, it's not.
No, but that's what I'm saying. In Karachi, more people live in apartments than in Lahore. And that's because of that. But if you're talking about densification of the urban core, that's one way to do it. One can think about it if that's possible. If it's not possible, then you will have people. And there are poor people who are living out much more in the spread across the ring road of Lahore. You will see many more, you know, lower income developments there, and they still have to go in to town for variety. I gave you the example of UET, the universities, where they are located. You know, people are commuting. I know for a fact, and there's plenty of survey data, that people do have to commute. They, you know, it's not like Islamabad where everything could be contained in the urban center that way. So I agree with you. Ideally, we would have that, but it's not been possible.
Please.
I just want to correct one thing.
We talk about densification, not of the urban core in the case of Lahore. The urban core has densities of more than 10,000 persons per hectare. We are talking about densification of the periphery. The periphery, which has densities of 100 persons and less per hectare, that's where there is capacity. That's where there is invested infrastructure. That's where the upper and middle income people live.
Yeah, that's what I'm talking about, the new urban core. But I'm talking about like Gulberg or Defense or those areas which could be further densified. I'm not talking about the walled city and Mall Road. So I think we agree on that.
We just need walkable cities. Sorry.
I agree.
But no, that's fine, Kansas. See, Marve, I'd like you to talk about Karachi and the point that Professor Salim was raising. And also, I'd like to, because you talked about how, you know, after this pandemic, a lot of people are talking about public transport in the context of pollution, climate change, other things. So what are the mistakes that you think this government, the government made, I mean, the previous government's project, the government made when it comes to Orange Line and even other public transport in Pakistan, public transport projects in Pakistan, and how could those mistakes have been avoided?
I mean, I'm going to talk about like on a very like a general perspective of like how we did not even learn from when there was a huge lockdown between March onwards for like 2 months or whatever that period of severe lockdown was. In Karachi, one witnessed that city started growing naturally in a lot of aspects. When lockdown hua, there was less of human intervention and less of carbon emission. We saw that migratory birds were back into the city. The city sounded better. The air felt better. A lot of timings kind of worked out really well. I mean, I wrote an article on this whole lockdown aspect, mm-hmm. that this was a great time for the government to make a lot of changes and humanistic changes. For instance, you know, I mean, when we talk about the whole idea of city, Karachi, the city of lights or city, life city, 24-hour city, what does that really mean? It's actually a negative thing, if you think about it. New York and all of these cities are burdened with a lot of high cost. You need to close your city after a certain hour. And we saw that 6 p.m. onwards, the people managed, right? They went, they brought their grocery, they brought their stuff around. And 6-7 baje shahar band ho gaya. Usme ek tarah se shahar recuperate ho raha tha, ek tarah se theek ho raha tha, sahem raha tha. It was kind of connecting back into the nature. And that was the idea which kind of really was a learning point and pickup point for the government. Okay, how can we start looking at the city from a natural point of view rather than intervention and saying ke bhai do baje tak shahar ko khula rakho, kya zarurat hai? Population pollution aapki increase hoti hai usse, electricity ke upar burden aata hai. So all of that. And weekends pe when we saw ki jab 6 baje gaadiyon ko allowed nahi tha, to jo parameters the coastal area ke, people started walking, people started cycling, less cars were coming into the city. And that what was a great time of government to make pedestrian walkways, put balustrades, put things around, that was a time of actually observing and learning how the people were maneuvering around a pandemic. And I think it was a lost chance because ab wo wapas ye jo smart lockdown ne ab isne kuch nahi sikhana, isne kuch nahi batana. Wo jo severe lockdown tha usne sikhana tha shahar ko bahut kuch. And so ye ek aspect hai. Dusri baat jo Salim sahab keh rahe the around verticality, I think Karachi has been a disaster when it comes to verticality. I mean, it creates a lot of isolation. The whole idea of mohalla has decreased. People do not know who their next door neighbors are. So that has also created a lot of mental anxiety in people, and we've witnessed it. We've seen the difference between a ground plus 14 apartment to a ground plus 3 ki building mein kitna farak hai. Ground plus 3 mein architecturally speaking, humanistic way mein aapka zyada connection hota hai apne neighbor ke saath. Jaise hi aap verticality ki density mein aage chale jate hain, and you start thinking about like 14 floors and 16 floors, it creates not just only infrastructure mess. It creates more responsibilities on government possibilities of ke pani ka kharcha. Khair, hamari to Karachi mein bahut hi mukhtalif problems hain jo ke Lahore ke, I can't compare. But you can't compare Lahore to Islamabad. That's a completely two different examples, you know. I mean, it's a much more planned city. And Lahore, of course, as you said, it's a historical city. But sprawling aspect of it was like going outwards is something that needs to be talked about and needs to be discussed.
Yes, no, I mean, that's what I was saying, that, you know, there are certain kinds of planning which can be applied to Islamabad, which you can't apply to Lahore. So I agree with you. Just the point on the pandemic, you know, this is something I'm researching quite a bit now for the, especially with my role on the Global Environment Facility, we're getting a lot of proposals around what can cities do to harness the dividends of the pandemic in some way. I think clearly, work from home is going to be an important variable which we will need to consider how far it goes. There is a lot of uncertainty currently about where this will go. It's clear that certain kinds of professions will benefit from this and certain professions will not. There is also a great concern that because of hypersensitivity to hygiene, people will not be using public transit as much. And so there has been some research to try and look into that. So I think that's an important area. We should keep our eyes on that. But all of the current, like if you look at retrospectively, what has happened to cities with big disruptions, they have usually come back in some form that is very much aligned with, you know, human interaction with each other. So I personally think that cities are not doomed by any means. Cities are going to still continue to thrive, and there will be this propensity to come together and find creative ways forward. So, but this is definitely an area that Pakistan should keep an eye on in terms of what lessons can be learned.
Kana sahab, I'd like to ask you what balance can be sought to ensure that, you know, now that, you know, this project has been made, and it's not going anywhere. So what balance can be sought to ensure benefits exceed the cost and compensations are made for the consequential cost? I mean, is there any balance that can be?
Well, I think the only thing, whether you call it balance or benefit or making do with something that has been done, what in any case, we have to get back to normalcy. That was the one lesson that the COVID pandemic strict lockdowns ensured, that Lahore, the most polluted city amongst the three most polluted cities in the world, in 2 weeks came down to healthy levels of air quality. So, and this is the kind, this is teaching us what a normal living planet, normal life, human existence should be. It should not be whizzing around in a mad rush in motor cars and aeroplanes all over the place. This is killing us. And then I'd like to say a couple of things. One about Islamabad's wonderful planned city. Salim Saab, Islamabad was planned by Doxiadis for the clients who insisted it should be planned that way, it's a complete class divided city. Each sector, you in a social gathering, the moment you ask aap kahan rehte hain, H sector, E, oh, acha, baap phir milenge. E, F, F16 mein rehte. The whole city is designed in this kind of class. The majority of the working population lives far away in the, I believe, H and I sectors. The work is in the central, the secretariat, the red zone. So this is a crazy city in any case. It, you cannot survive in this without vehicularized transportation. Yes, the sectors are a very good idea, but they're not self-contained because the people who live there work 20 miles away. So that's a very bad example, Salim Saab, that you've given of so-called planned cities. So one more thing you keep referring to is about high-rise. High-rise is not coterminous with high density. There is no connection. Where do you have the concentrations of high-rise? Abu Dhabi. Where is Burj Khalifa? Where are the high-rises in Pakistan? Karachi, Icon Tower, is that a high-density area? Where is the high-density of Karachi, Lahari? More than 4,000 persons per hectare. What high-rises? This is, there is no connection. Manhattan, as a skyscraper city, has the density of our Iqbal Town. Iqbal Town has two-story, three-story, four-story walk-up apartments. So please get your figures right. There's some kind of strange idea that...
May I just respond on to, thank you for that. You know, the reason why you do not have coincidence of high rises and high density is because of poverty. I mean, do you really want a situation where livelihoods in Pakistan, we have 20 people living in 500 square feet? I mean, you know, you just have to think about that's why, and that's not a future I want for our population. I want our population to have a higher quality of life. And so for that, you do need certain level of verticality. But I take your point, it's not essential. About Islamabad, I would say that Doxiadis did not say that you should make E7 the elite sector. It was the way in which then the plots were designed. But if you look at some of the newer sectors in Islamabad, like E11, they have much smaller plot sizes. And they have been that's been deliberately done so you can have middle to lower income people also living in there. So I think CDA can do much more. I was talking about the macro plan. The macro plan idea of polycentric development, where you have a commercial center and a marketplace all around, surrounded by residential, makes it very walkable. Now, if CDA didn't do a good job implementing, that's their problem. But the basic design is something that we should aspire for. And definitely the suburban sprawl problem is there in Islamabad. It has happened partly because it's got this twin city situation with Rawalpindi. Again, rapid transit helped with that. People were initially against the metro bus in Islamabad. Now, you know, even the white collar people are taking the metro bus to Pindi because it was such a hassle otherwise getting there. You know, so I think we have to look at the long game on this. I totally respect the view of the conservationists, but we need to have longer term thinking.
We have a few questions from the audience, and the audience can actually ask more if we have time. Mavi, I'd like to ask this question from you. How can we keep the city heritage intact while improving city infrastructures to improve public lives?
I mean, this is something like one has to look into, again, not on a master plan, but mostly on a cluster basis, at least for Karachi. I feel like each mohallas need to be allocated and looked into through the community point of view, like what are the issues, local issues need to be understood, and then intervention and intersection needs to take place. So it's a more grassroots level of interjectory.
Okay. And Kamal Saab, I'd like to ask this question from you, but do you think the overall benefit of such projects is more than some individual losses, or do you disagree with that?
I completely disagree with this. The overall destruction of these projects, as I said, is killing us. It is suicidal. If we want to kill ourselves, then have more of these projects. But this is not a way to sustain, to survive human life. And it is a disaster, not just in Lahore, worldwide. You talk about standards of quality of life, and the present standard of living of the world is not sustainable. In Pakistan, our present standard of living is 120% overshoot compared with our biodiversity. You cannot go on doing this. It is killing us.
Professor Saleem, there's another question related to what Kamal Saab has just said, that, you know, what is more important for the public, in your opinion, the environmental perspective or ease in access to affordable public transport?
I think both are synergistic. There are some areas where, so I think you can have much more environmentally conscious planning with urban transit. Of course, there will be some areas where you cannot have a win-win situation. One of the things which the elevated design of the metro does is that in essence, it tries to mitigate the impact on the ground. Of course, it has certain visual implications then, but the aesthetics of cities change. You know, so when we talk about environmental from the point of view of aesthetics, wind power, for example, is a classic case. A lot of people think wind turbines are very ugly, but they are very green, and now people are considering them a very nice aesthetic. You have wind power on, you know, the coast of many cities in Europe, and people go out just to see it like a tourist attraction. Before, people didn't like them very much, and the conservationists were upset because the birds were being killed by them. So, you know, there's always going to be a shift. You have to have trade-offs. That's the role of environmental planning, to grapple with those trade-offs and try and find a path which is able to optimize as best possible.
Okay, so since we have just less than 3 minutes left, I'd like a last comments from each of you. Marvi, I'll start with you. And then tie urban planning and environment and mega projects.
I would say that the city needs to reflect upon from the learnings of the last few, this entire year. I think it's a very important episode that has taken place. And we got to understand the urban planning from a perspective of nature and environment, and also integrate it in an urban perspective in a very regional manner, rather than thinking from influences from external sources.
Ji, Kamal Saab.
Well, this trade-off between so-called progress, development, and wealth generation and elimination of poverty, what we actually, the trade-off, the actual facts on the ground are that the trade-off is this economic growth, the downside is the elimination, the end of all human existence. Already we have species extinction. Man is going to kill himself with these. That's a pretty bad trade-off.
Ji, Professor Saleem.
Well, I'm really heartened that we have a process in Pakistan where we've got strident debates with conservationists. This whole process has given me a lot of hope that we have noble people like Kamal Saab who are pushing the envelope, challenging the authorities. We have also the business interests and others engaging. You know, that's the way a functional democracy should work. We have a judicial setup. So I remain optimistic that through this engagement, we should be all willing to engage. We should be willing to compromise as much as possible. I think we do have a brighter future ahead for Pakistan. So I feel very optimistic through this process. And I greatly appreciate even those who disagree with me.
Thank you, everyone. I'd like to thank Kamal Saab, Marvi, Professor Saleem, and thank you, everybody, for watching this. I hope and I have actually learned a lot from this debate, and I hope that you have too. Thank you very much. And I'd also like to thank UBF, which is the prime sponsor or lead sponsor of SOT. Thank you.
Thank you.
Bye.
Thank you.